वेलकम लर्नर, आई वेलकम यू टू दिस कोर्स BES 122 कंटेम्प्ररी इंडिया एंड एजुकेशन. आई एम हियर विद द यूनिट 2 ऑफ दिस कोर्स, दैट इज एस्पिरेशंस ऑफ इंडियन सोसाइटी. नाउ बिफोर स्टार्टिंग दिस वीडियो लेसन, लेट मी इंट्रोड्यूस माई सेल्फ. आई एम नील कमल सरन, फैकल्टी स्कूल ऑफ एजुकेशन, इग्नू. यू मस्ट हैव सीन स्मॉल चिल्ड्रंस, दे आर मेकिंग रील्स एंड अपलोडिंग इट ऑन यूट्यूब. मेनी चिल्ड्रंस आर डूइंग सो, दे आर ऑल्सो मेकिंग द रील्स एंड अपलोडिंग इट ऑन द यूट्यूब, बट ऑल चिल्ड्रन दे आर नॉट गेटिंग द सेम काइंड ऑफ फेम. दे डोंट हैव मच मोर लर्नर्स. One child who is uploading his or her video, he is getting a lot of fame. But another who is uploading his or her reel, he or she is not getting so much of fame. Then what is this? These are the aspirations. The child has the aspiration, or he or she aspires to become a good person who can make a good video, good reel. But everyone cannot do so. And you can see the person or middle class family, the youth of a middle class family, they aspire to get a good job, or they aspire to get a government job. Similarly, every individual is different, and they aspire for their own thing, what they want to achieve for. But our Indian society, it is very heterogeneous society. We cannot say that the Indian society is aspire for particularly this thing. But in spite of those things, sociologists have tried to bring it to a homogeneity. What will be the major aspirations of Indian society? And today we will talk about those aspirations. Now, before starting the video lesson, let us see the objectives of this video lesson. After going through this video, you will be able to describe the various aspirations of Indian society. You will be able to relate these aspirations to the prevailing scenario of India. Also, you will be able to analyze and discuss social order and social justice. Now, first area of aspirations of Indian society is nationalism. The most important issue in front of the governance of any nation is to preserve and maintain its sovereignty. No progress or development of any kind is possible as long as the geographical borders of a country are safe from external aggression. At one time, we are saying that no progress of a country is possible unless and until it is safe from external aggression, and other time it is also important that it should be safe from, it should not be disturbed from internal strife. India is a multilingual, multi-ethnic, multi-religious federal system, and thus is a confluence of a diversity of different cultures and lifestyles. India has shown to the world that with the help of a democratic and nationalistic principles, people speaking different languages, having different castes and religions, following different patterns of life, can coexist and sustain themselves. But presently, India is being troubled by the phenomenon of disintegration. In the national context, this disintegration is an unfortunate phase because it is a serious pointer to the unwelding of links which solidify the essential component of a cohesive group. There are petty issues, they pose obstacles in the way of nationalism. Like the first obstacle is several religions. In India, we follow several religions. These religions are based on beliefs But what we are doing? We, in the name of religion, we are fighting with each other. We are feeling that our religion is superior and other religion is inferior. So these are the obstacles. The several types of religions which are prevailing in Indian society, they create an obstacles in the way of nationalism. Another obstacle is different communities. You can see that in India we have different communities, different in even in one religion there are different caste. In one religion you will see the different sects are there, different types of thoughts are there. For example, in Muslim you will see Shia and Sunnis are there. In Hindu religion also it is divided into four caste. So there are different communities which exist in India, which creates an obstacle in the way of nationalism. So we need to overcome these obstacles. Then another obstacle is various political parties. You can see that India is a democratic country, and various parties, several political parties exist in India. We don't have single parties like Russia and China. We have many more parties which are based on the caste or geographical reasons like that. So it is also creating an obstacle in the way of nationalism, because different political parties have different ideologies, and sometimes what they think, instead of taking care of national interest, they take care of their own interest, their own profit. So this is also an obstacle in the way of nationalism. Another one is regional states. India is divided into a number of states. It has also created an obstacle in the way of nationalism. We are fighting in the name of our state, that we belong to this state and they belong to that state. They are inferior, we are superior, like that. We are fighting in the name of these different types of these different states. So these states are also creating an obstacle in the way of nationalism. Another is several languages. You can see that several languages exist in our country, and in the name of language also we fight with each other. Even in schools you can see that the children, small children, they fight with each other because of their language. Because of their language, that they tell other children that you belong to this language or you speak this language, your language is inferior, and I speak this language. Similarly, what they do, they create or they develop a we feeling, or they will friendship with those children who belong to or who speak their language. Like for example, the Odia people, if a child he or she speaks Odia, then what he or she will do, he will try to develop friendship with those who will speak Odia. Similarly, the people who will speak Maharashtrian, they will try to develop friendship with the other children who speaks Maharashtrian. So what is this? This is an obstacle in the way of nationalism, and we need to overcome these obstacles if we want to develop a feeling of nationalism among our children. Another obstacle in the way of nationalism is economic disparities. There are economic disparities. Some are rich, some are poor, some are workers, some are employees, male, female. So there is economic disparities. Sometimes the poor people, they don't get education because they don't have money. Whereas the people, rich people, those who have money, they get a good quality of education, they get higher education, and minimum, forget about higher education, they get at least minimum education, which the poor people cannot afford to get. So there are economic disparities which should be taken care of. Another is social inequalities. Social inequalities are there in our societies, and lack of worthy leadership. Leadership is also there is lack of worthy leadership in our country. They take care of their personal interest rather than national interest, and lack of appropriate education in our country. This is an important obstacle in the way of nationalism. If we provide good education to the children, we respect their individuality, we provide them opportunity for participation, then and only then we can develop a feeling of nationalism among them. At the same time, can you expect a person who is a street hawker that he or she has a feeling of nationalism? Or the person who doesn't have or who has to struggle for the meal for one time, he or she can develop a feeling of nationalism? So their basic need should be fulfilled first if we want to develop a feeling of nationalism among them. Now next is the question comes, what is education for nationalism? Education for nationalism in reality refers to education which is imparted for national unity and for the inculcation of the spirit of social service. It is oriented towards national reconstruction and national progress. The national unity or integration is impossible, or we can say that is possible only when citizens belonging to different races, classes, communities, states, languages, provinces, they develop a feeling of love towards their nation and strive together for the national progress and for further national interest. But this is only possible when their basic needs are fulfilled. If their basic needs are fulfilled, then and only then we can develop a feeling of nationalism among them. Education helps in national progress when it leads to economic betterment of the country. It should eradicate social evils. It must be ensured that the people do not fight with each other on the issues of languages, caste, creed, and color. Today, the Indian society has to aspire for the growth of the nationalistic spirit. This is the only way India can hope to survive the threats to its territorial integrity as well as to its social fabric. It is essential to continuously strive to integrate multi-complex, heterogeneous subgroups into the mainstream of a cohesive national group. Next aspiration of Indian society is social order. Now, if we talk about at the biological level, human beings, they ensure the survival of the species. But what is the difference between man and an animal? The ability to think or critically think, thinking critically, empathy, and to act for the interest of others is the major difference between man and an animal. So, the social order is nothing but it is the sum total arrangement and discipline according to which the society functions. Social order is the arrangement of the society. In the broadest sense, our society relies on social order. It is the link between the traditions, processes, material, cooperation, control and freedom, etc. Social order has also been defined as constellation of social institutes. For example, people have in society decides that, or there is a tradition in the society that people have to work for their living, for to make money, people have to work. Similarly, killing other is an unaccepted act. So these are the traditions or moral values, ethical values, which a person has to follow in order to live in a society. And what does society returns back to the human? If the human follows the traditions which lies in a society, what does society do it? Society provides the person respect, love and belongingness. So the human being and the society, they depend on each other. There is a mutual relationship between human being and society, and social order are the sum total of the arrangements of the values, traditions, beliefs in order to make the person disciplined so that he or she can spend his or life in a disciplined manner, in a socially accepted manner. There are different components of social order. First one is family and kinship. The family has also has all along been given a very high regard in this country. The family performs some essential social functions such as care and socialization of the young, as well as management and integration of adult life and personality. The family may also be an economic producing and consuming unit, as well as procreator of succeeding generations. Unfortunately, contemporary India is witnessing an erosion of the family values indicators, being increased divorce rates, extramarital affairs, single parent children, live-in relationships, etc. The result is that our youth is suffering from loss of identity and loss of socio-emotional integration. Now, family is the smallest institution where a child learns the social values. He or she learns the traditions, the beliefs, the culture which are being followed in his or her family. And what he or she learns in his or her family will ultimately contributes to the national development. So it is important that the culture of the values of our family should be preserved if we want to make our Indian society a developed and progressive society. Then we need to preserve these values of family. Another component of social order is economic order. Social order can retain its integrity and vitality if it creates resources that meets the various demand of its population. These resources might be in the form of basic needs or qualitative needs, that is education, wealth, property, etc. And the manner of resource distribution in a society too relates to its economic order. The Indian economic order indicates unequal generation and distribution of resources. Though there are constant attempts at lessening these inequalities, the Indian society has to aspire for the revamping of the economic order, which will have far-reaching implications on the other form of social order as well. So, Indian society should aspire for the equal distribution of the resources to all the persons of the society. Another component of social order is political order. Now, what is political order? Political order of a society, collectively called the government of the state, performs the functions of integration, domination, mediation, mobilization, are essential, which are essential for the very existence of society. India is a democratic country where so many political parties exist, and the political system is the prime agent for ensuring equitable distribution of resources. Respect for the rule of law, curbing of anti-social activities, punishment of illegal activity, and correction of disputes. But the present political order in India has unfortunately become too self-obsessed and is misusing its power for the fulfillment of vested interest. In fact, an ineffective political order has been the breeding ground for almost all India's problems. Thus, one of the major aspirations of Indian society has to be the cessation of political order, and this can be achieved through social will. Another component of social order is religious order. Religion is defined as an organized system of beliefs and rituals oriented towards a reality different from and believed to be superior to that of the ordinary life. Religion are basically a tool that keeps a human being disciplined. These are the beliefs and rituals which makes the human being disciplined, and it provides peace, comfort, and fulfillment to human existence, and is a potent force of control and order. But it can be misused to create terrorism and fundamentalism. You must have seen there are so many wars which occurs because of this religion. People think that my religion is superior and other religion is not superior. So we need to overcome this type of thinking. India should aspire to continually guard these influences and maintain religion as a tool of discipline and spiritual development. Another component of social order is legal order. Legal system is drawn from three primary sources. First is common laws, second one is religious laws, and third is civil law. Common laws, property law, marriage law, these are common law. There are some religious laws also which exist in our country, and there are civil laws also which exist in our countries. These laws are essential for any society as rules that have been devised for the conduct of social life. And obedience to law is mandatory, and violation of laws are punished by the organized force of the community or readdressed by the judicial machinery. Have you ever think that what happens if there is no legal law for killing other person? We cannot imagine. So these laws are important, mandatory for us, and if we violate these laws, we should be punished in order to keep our country working in an accepted manner. So the Indian aspiration in this regard has to be in strengthening the legal order for efficient action and early redressal, so that the citizens have faith in it for their protection and security from the nefarious elements of the society. Another aspiration of Indian society is social justice. This is an important aspiration of Indian society. Society all over the world, they are differentiated by hierarchies which are based on social stratification, which is nothing but a systematic pattern through which such valued objects as property, power and prestige are distributed unequally within the society. Remember, these values means power, properties and prestige, they are distributed unequally within the society. In India too, you can see the gap between the rich and the poor, male and the female, worker and the employer, or the young and the old. These are the basic questions of property, power and prestige. And it is very disappointing that one talks about unequal distribution in a democratic country like India, where equality is the basic principle enshrined in its constitution. One of the most glaring inequalities in modern India is that there is an unequal property, income and basic services. Still, there are number of people who do not get two meals a day. They have to struggle for two meals a day. Women still don't get equal treatment in some societies and areas. Now, there are two views for social justice. One view says that individual capacity and intelligence should not be a source of unequal reward. Instead, all individuals deserve an equal share of the collective surplus resulting from cooperation. And other view says that autonomous individuals being obliged to share their success with the less fortunate is unjust and unfair. At one time, one view says that the individual intelligence and capacity should not be a source of unequal reward. Instead, it should be shared among all. But another view says that if autonomous individuals did achieve something of their own, that achievement should not be shared with others. That sharing is unjust and unfair. So, social justice refers to fair and equitable division of resources, opportunities and privilege in the society. There are four principles of social justice. One is equity, means fairness in the distribution of resources. Another principle is access, means access of, there should be an opportunity to access the resources which are available in the society. Next principle is participation. All persons should get an opportunity to participate in the decisions related to them. And the last one is rights. To protect the right, the people feel that this is unfair. Means we can understand this principle with the help of one example, that if a person who is rich does a wrong act and the same act is done by a poor person, so the rule should be that they, both of them should be given same kind of punishment. It is not that the rich one will not be punished, and the poor, because he is poor, he doesn't have so much of resource, he or she should be punished, and the rich person should not be punished. It is not that. So the right of the person should not be violated. He or she must have the equal right, in spite of the fact that he is rich or poor, or he is male or she is female. Now, Indian society have to aspire for an optimal pathway in between these two extreme positions stated above. What were the two statements, two views? One says that the individual intelligence or achievements should not be shared. Sharing is unjust and unfair, while other says that individual achievements should be shared among all, so that they also can benefit from that. So, Indian society, they need to aspire for an optimal pathway in between these two types of views. The single most decisive factor in this regard is the provision of educational opportunity. If we provide the first, or we can say that the smallest step towards the social justice is the provision of educational opportunity to all. Next aspiration of Indian society is social mobility. Social mobility shows the nature of dynamism and change in social system. We have experienced many changes in the society in terms of occupation, living standards, job profile, work nature, conservation to open-mindedness, and acceptance of many social dealings happening. This is because of the factor of social mobility. Now, if you read the life journey of Dhirubhai Ambani, who is a famous businessman, his father was a government teacher. Now he has provided Dhirubhai Ambani a good type of education, and because of that education, he was able to become a great businessman. And now what his children they are doing, they are also growing his tradition. Whatever he has started, his children, they are growing those startups, those business. So this is social mobility. They have changed their standard, living standard, and this is an example of social mobility. And social mobility may be of many types, such as horizontal mobility, it may be vertical, it may be upward, downward, intergenerational and intragenerational, means within a generation also mobility takes place, and there is also an occupational mobility. Horizontal mobility is a mobility where person changes his or her status or occupation, but overall social standing remains the same. For example, if an engineer or a doctor changes his or her occupation and becomes a teaching faculty in an engineering college or medical institution, then the original status of the person remains the same. Such social mobility is horizontal mobility, whereas vertical mobility refers to the change in occupation, economic status and political status from one position to another. Like in the last example, from teaching job to a businessman, this is a vertical mobility. And also the last example was related with intergenerational mobility. Similarly, if a sarpanch of a panchayat becomes a member of legislative assembly or member of parliament, that is in an ascending order from lowest to highest. This type of mobility is vertical mobility. It goes from downward to upward. On the contrary, it happens from social, high social or occupational status to low social status is called descending vertical mobility. If a person goes from upward to downward, it is called downward or descending vertical mobility. Another aspiration of Indian society is universalism, which implies that it is possible to apply generalized norms, values or concept to all people and culture irrespective of the place where they are located. For example, the United Nations Universal Declaration of Human Rights. United Nations has declared a Universal Declaration of Human Rights. The person, they can, it is related to education, it is related to marriage. So, universalism is the possibilities to apply the generalized norm, values or concepts to all the people irrespective of the country or place or the geographical area where they are located. And the world today is a global village. The unprecedented expansion of information and communication technology has cut across geographical boundaries and cultural barriers. There is one document called Challenges of Education, 1986. According to that document, we have always maintained amicable relations with all countries without aligning with any power block. Our place in the third world is based on technology, philosophy of mutual respect, non-inferences and active cooperation. We have fully supported to the idea of solidarity among the non-aligned and stressed the importance of the new international economic order. While this policy has promoted international peace and cooperation, it has given our country a place of honor in the Committee of Nations. What a noteway is that, despite suffering a great deal due to border conflicts, external aggression and war, India has been able to maintain its ideology of universal harmony and brotherhood. We all depend on each other. Even in one society, we depend on each other. Similarly, we depend on other countries for our development. We cannot keep ourselves away from these things. Like we cannot say that we are independent from other countries. We depend on other countries for our progress. So universalism is one of the major aspirations of Indian society. The aspiration for the future would be establishment of new information order, networking and collaborative endeavors in the international arena for expanding the technical, professional, educational and cultural knowledge base have to be taken up in a big way. Then India can stand its true ideology that knowledge and friendship knows no boundaries. They are indeed universal in nature. Now today, in this video lesson, we have studied the major aspirations of Indian society. The major aspirations of Indian societies are nationalism, social order, social justice, social mobility and universalism. Now here there are some assessment questions for you. After going through video lesson, you will have to describe the various aspirations of Indian society. The second question is you will relate the aspirations of Indian society to the prevailing scenario of India. And the third question is analyze and discuss social order and social justice. Thank you.